crowd that we have in front of us, those of us who are sort of taking part in this, the jurors and three teams. I would like now to have the three teams introduced. The captain will tell who they are. First, the team of Germany, please.
Yes, good morning, ladies and gentlemen.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Igor Gotlibovich. I'm the captain of the German team, and we're very glad to be here today. Our team members are Kerstin Weller, Olaf Merkert, Bleda Patria, and Benedikt Stegmeier. Thank you.
And now, please, the Korean team captain, would you introduce your team?
Good morning. We're the Korean national team. My name is Kim Hong-kyun. I'm the captain of the Korean team. And these are our teammates, Cho Han-sup, Park Hyung-soo, Son Young-mok, and Kim Soo-kyung. And it's an honor to be here, and I hope everyone enjoys the finals. Thank you. Thank you.
And the third team on the stage from Croatia, please introduce yourselves.
So, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We are the Croatian team. Our members are Ivan Sudic, Milan Marković, Joško Jelicic, Marin Lukas, and I am the captain, Damian Pelt. So we're very pleased to be here, and we hope we'll have a good fight. Thank you.
Now I would like to introduce the jury to you. Crowd.
Okay,
go ahead. You will have 12 minutes, as you know.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It is a great honor for me to present to you here today our solution to problem number 2, shade. Let me recall the task shortly. If small non-transparent objects are illuminated with light, patterns in the shadows can be observed. What information about these objects can be obtained from those patterns? Let me first give you a short overview. I will first give a short introduction on patterns themselves. I will present our experiment. Then I will come to the theory describing wave optics, including the Huygens principle, and I will develop a simulation which allows us to simulate such patterns and also reconstruct objects from those. And then I will apply our knowledge to different real objects. And then I will conclude. Well, what is the difference between normal light sources like a light bulb and a laser? Why have we chosen a laser? Because if we look at the shadow in a normal light source, we see it is blurred with distance, thus the information is lost. However, in coherent light, we can observe patterns due to the phenomenon of interference. And we wonder if this could help us. Let me present you our experimental setup. You can also see the experimental setup here. It is right the same. It contains a laser, two polarizers to control the intensity, a beam expander. We put a small object inside the beam and we project the patterns on the CCD chip of a camera. Now we can demonstrate this actually here. Now you can see the patterns. A small object, the object in the pattern is a small shape, but you cannot recognize this, the shape sharply. Next slide, please. Now, first of all, we wanted to actually measure the profile of our laser beam without any object. We will need this later on in our simulation. So, here you see a reference picture, and we assume that the intensity on the chip is proportional to electric field squared. And so we can approximate our laser beam with a Gaussian profile and determine a characteristic radius of approximately 2.5 millimeters. So our object would be slightly smaller. Now, what we observe are really various patterns, and dependent on the object, we can either recognize the object directly from the pattern, or we only observe some combination of fringes. Now here, you see an example of a wire tip. The next one is the air, perhaps you could guess that, but what would be represented by this pattern? You will learn this later. Let me first come to the theory. This will be crucial to understand the phenomenon. The Huygens-Fresnel principle tells us that each point of a wavefront emits a secondary circular wave, and And this, we can calculate the electric field in any other point behind this wavefront by adding together all those circular waves. As you can see, for example, in this point. Each circular wave is described by this simple equation, where the exponential factor encounters for the change in phase, and the r in the denominator encounters for the loss in amplitude. Consider two planes. One, the object plane, where we know the intensity distribution, and one, a second plane, where we would like to calculate the intensity. Therefore, we can calculate all the circular waves by this integral over the first plane. Now we will use some approximations, which are valid if L is rather big or, and the object is small. We will use this Fourier expansion and put it into this integral, and finally we arrive at our transformation rule, which is the following. Here you see F is the Fourier transform, which is simply another symbol for the integral we have seen before. And we can also apply inverse transformation of this formula, thus obtaining field in plane E1 from the field E2 in the second plane, so in the plane of the patterns. So perhaps we could really reconstruct the object from the patterns, but there was one problem. We really need big distances to make this approximation. Therefore, we will need to use a trick, because we do not have distances of 15 meters. But we can introduce a far field plane which has this distance and will lie approximately over there in our experimental setup. And we can transform from plane 2 to the far field plane and then backwards to plane 1. And in both cases, we can apply our approximated transformation and we will obtain valid results. There's another problem, namely, we only have the absolute value of the electric field. But as we are using small objects and nearly a plane wave, the phase information which is lost will not influence the reconstruction crucially. So let us look at the simulation. These are simulated results for two objects. One is a pinhole and another is a plate of the same size. Let us first look at the far field image. You will probably recognize those patterns because it is well known what patterns are produced by an illuminated rectangle. So the far field patterns are just the same. But the patterns observed in finite distance would be rather different because our laser beam is finite and not infinite. In the lower part you can clearly recognize those rings. They remind us of Fresnel rings on the Fresnel zone plate. Well, this is not a coincidence because we mainly have interference between the plane laser wave and a small disturbed area here which can be treated as nearly a point source. So we have those ranges. And if we apply the reconstruction from real parts, from the absolute value of the field only, we see that in this case where the object is not where we only have a small object, the reconstruction does not reveal any information. But if the object only closes a small part of the laser beam, the reconstruction allows us to recognize the actual object. Now let us apply this knowledge to real objects. Here, for example, you see a light bulb with a heating wire. Here, the pattern and the reconstruction. We can clearly see in the pattern, we cannot actually recognize that there are three wires, and we can even recognize this structure, which is due to the winding of the wire on the top. Let us come to another object. We actually wanted to vary different parameters and investigate how the patterns and the quality of reconstruction depend on the parameters of our object. We have designed a test object which was printed then on a transparency, which was this here, and we just put a transparency with printed text on it in the laser beam. Now, we have varied the text size from 0.3 to 1.0 millimeters, and we also varied the distance from object to screen. Now, let us look at the patterns. You see, for small distances and big objects, the object can still be recognized by its shadow, but the shadow is only slightly blurred by those diffraction patterns. For big distances, we obtain patterns like this. And I really don't believe that you can read what was the initial object from this pattern. And this is actually the object I have shown you at the beginning. And if we apply our reconstruction algorithm, the following happens. We can now clearly see what piece of writing was put in the laser beam. Let us look at this picture in more detail. You see the initial object and the reconstruction. We see some characteristic principles, like for example those pixels can clearly be recognized in the reconstruction. Now, what actually we need the distance between the object plane and the pattern plane for reconstruction. What actually happens if we put the wrong distance, if we do not know the distance exactly? Now we can vary the distance, and we observe those smooth change from the interference pattern right down to the initial object or to the reconstructed object. What does this mean? This means we are actually looking at reconstructed fields in different planes all the way between the camera and the object. And by this, I will come on this effect later, by this we can actually calculate fields in different planes and obtain a resolution in third dimension. But let me first introduce another principle. To even further increase the contrast of our reconstruction, we can use difference reconstruction. This means we do not just reconstruct the pattern like this one, but we also use a reference, which is just a picture of a beam taken under same conditions but without any object. And then we build a difference, and the difference, you can see that the difference and the pattern are actually complementary. So they sum up to the beam. And the reconstructions of both the direct reconstruction and the difference reconstruction are also complementary, but in this object we do have better contrast because the laser beam is actually faded away. So we will use those methods for further investigation. Let us look at the hair. We have performed computations at higher resolution. This was actually the resolution of our camera, the pixel size of our camera, and it also corresponds to the resolution we can obtain by this method. So you see, it is approximately 7.3 micrometer. And if we reconstruct this at this high resolution, it will take a bigger time for our reconstruction program, but we obtain results and we can zoom in and we can determine the width of the hair. And it is 0.08 millimeters. So we can use this method for measuring small size. Now, what we do next, we have noticed, or I'm afraid you cannot see it quite clearly, but in this region, if we reconstruct at the distance between the hair and the pattern, so the camera, you can see small fringes in this region which are rather unsharp. So we ask ourselves, what are they due to? And then we try to vary the distance, and in this case you see a reconstruction for 40 centimeters, and what we can clearly see is a bright dot here. So we see the hair is no longer sharp, but we again observe diffraction patterns, but we have a bright dot in this region. This means 10 centimeters behind our hair is a small dust particle, and this was due to the polarizer. So on the one of the polarizers, there was a dust particle, and we can recognize it, and we can measure the distance in the third dimension between the dust particle and the hair. So if we have multiple small objects which do not interact with each other, we will be able to reconstruct in three dimensions. Now let me sum up what we have done. First of all, patterns which are useful only occur with coherent light. Secondly, if we record such patterns, phase information is lost because we only record the amplitude. Now, for small objects and planar waves as we used here, this is completely sufficient to reconstruct small objects. Well, and all I have to say to you now, you can read here. Well, I'm sorry, perhaps we will need the reconstruction. I'm not sure if you can recognize it, but this is actually the writing. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for your report. Now, the opponents can ask questions to the reporter. I think if you can keep the microphone slightly further away from the mouth, it would be very loud on the other one.
Is it okay like this?
Yes.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Hansel Duke from Korean team. And from now on, and first of all, thank you for your nice solution about problem number 2G. And I have some question for you. First, in the beginning part of the presentation, you said white light will not make the patterns behind the objects.
Yes.
Be blurred. You said about this?
Yes.
And why are they blurred?
Well, this is due to two reasons. One reason is that we normally have objects of finite dimensions. Can we have the next slide, please? This one, yes. It is actually also a shadow simulated with a finite light source, so we here see the shadow surge. The second reason, especially for small objects, is that white light also experiences diffraction. But because the light is not coherent, it will be in the region of geometrical shadow, but it will not interfere and create patterns.
and use the laser light in your experiments?
Yes.
And do you know the coherence length of it?
Well, we have not measured the coherence length. Normal values for such a helium neon laser would be between 3 and 10 meters approximately, perhaps even longer.
And then you showed about the equations.
Sorry?
You showed me the equations.
The equations, sure.
Fourier Kirilov integral.
The Fourier integral. I can. That one?
No, the before one.
The before, yes.
Okay. And in your experiment, you used a beam expander. And you made a parallel light.
We made parallel light, yes.
I think the parallel light is Fraunhofer diffraction. Fraunhofer diffraction.
Fraunhofer
diffraction.
Fraunhofer diffraction, yes.
Not a Fresnel diffraction.
Yes.
And do you know the factor which determines the difference between Fraunhofer and Fresnel in this equation?
Well, we actually use Fraunhofer approximation, meaning we use Fourier optics. This is due to this approximation. This is due to the distance between the object and the second plane where we calculate the field being small, being big compared to the size of the object.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. The opponent has 3 minutes to prepare the opposition.
Okay, organized presentation. And they showed us some real demonstration of experiment like this, and I really easily understood what they used in their experiment. And they wrote some neatly written theories, and they used many variables and objects during their experiment, and they used some simulation, and they could predict what the difference pattern will be, and they also deeply analyzed the experimental results. And they have some clear conclusions, but there are some disadvantages too. So first, they are lack of numerical values, like the sizes of the object they used in the experiments, and I think they are lack of some detailed explanation about reconstruction algorithm and principles. And I think many parameters mentioned was jealous analysis, and I think they have the lack of physical qualitative explanation, but they had only quantitative analysis. So these are the discussion points. First, I want to know the physical meanings of equations that they used in the presentation, and what is the difference between the light, white light, and the laser beam? And they said they won't be different pattern when they use white light. And I want to know the difference of it. And in the problem, they asked us to observe the patterns in the shadows when we use the small objects, and what is the definition of the small objects, and can you have any prediction when using polygon objects? In case of your experiment, you used some kind of real objects like light bulb. So I want to know the prediction when you use polygons, like simple objects. And I want to know the intensity distribution on the screen of the diffraction pattern. And I want to know the reason why there appears the same pattern when using aperture and plate who has the same size as you shown in the presentation. And shall we discuss from now on?
I think I should first reply to some of your points. Well, first of all, to the physical meaning of Huygens' principle. It was rather crucial in this presentation. And, well, the physical meaning is actually that any point of the wavefront can be seen as a source of secondary circular waves. This is actually the whole physical meaning behind our mathematics, behind the integrals. And a second principle we really need and is widely applied in all fields of physics is the superposition principle. This means that we can just consider interference, so we can consider a direct sum of fields produced by different points,
okay,
and thus we obtain our pattern. So
okay,
this is the
you.
Physical background.
And can I see the next line?
Well,
okay. In this part, you use Fresnel-Kirchhoff integral.
Yes, it is
and
correct.
In this case, the beam expander makes the beam parallel.
Yes, I understand what you mean.
Okay.
Well,
and I want to know that what is the factor determines the characteristic of the diffraction? There is a two kind of diffraction, Fresnel and Fraunhofer.
I understand.
What determines the
Well, let me explain it to you. The Fresnel-Kirchhoff integral is just a very general expression which cannot only be applied in our case, but can be applied for any type of patterns produced by any kind of of non-dispersive waves in this case. And this is, and we do simplify this integral using approximations of Fraunhofer optics.
Okay. Then let's go back to the first slide, the third slide. And you said about white light, and they will be blurred.
Yes.
Why is the reason?
I actually sort of answered your question. There are two reasons. One reason is finite light size. If you look at my shadow over there, you will clearly see that the shadow is blurred because these light throws have finite dimensions. So we have a superposition of a lot of patterns, but they do not interfere. And the second reason will be diffraction, as I said. That means
thank you.
Oh.
And what will be the result when we make them parallel, like this?
If we make white light
parallel,
well, then we will still have diffraction. This will mean we will have a rather sharp shadow at close ranges, but the shadow will blur at bigger distances due to diffraction, actually. It will be even more. So light will come into the geometrical shadow region and blur the pattern.
Then do you know about the definition of coherence length? Coherence length.
I suppose I can tell you that. The coherence length is actually, in our case, if we consider a laser beam, it is a characteristic length distance between two rays from the same source at which we still can observe interference, meaning that the phase of those rays has a certain relation, a certain constant relation.
Okay. Then, can I see the patterns made by aperture and the plate?
Yeah, sure.
Whose field is rectangular? Okay. In the bar field, as you shown in this presentation, in the bar field, there's the same depression.
Yes. Well, it is a well-known fact. It is a well-known fact. You can observe it here, or you can observe it even for a slit and a wire. Can we have this?
And what is the reason of the same pattern appearance? What is the reason?
Well, the reason is actually that those two objects are complementary. So we can say that if we consider an infinite laser beam, so here you see, for example, two patterns for slit and wire, and we can say that this object and this that this object is actually the difference of infinite plane waves and this object. So the both objects, the only difference between two objects is actually the sign. One is positive and another is negative.
You mean that we can get perfectly the same patterns by using two complementary gradients, right?
We can at infinite distance, yes.
Because I think the center of the diffraction pattern, what is this?
Yes, it is a very good question, actually. This is mainly due to the reconstruction algorithm we use, because the reconstruction algorithm, we do not calculate integrals numerically. We only have a finite resolution. Therefore, we apply fast Fourier transform, which is an approximation for exact Fourier integrals for discrete data values. And this method has caused some minor errors.
But if you do not approximate it, the light passes through the wire. In case of a wire, the light is blocked by this wire.
Yes.
But in case of slit, the light can be penetrated through the slit. And part of the area that light can pass through is different.
Yes, it is. Well, the patterns would be exactly the same if we would have infinite plane waves. As I already told you, because in this case the objects are exactly complementary and the only difference will be the sign.
So you mean that you used the infinite light?
No, we used infinite.
That came from infinite distance.
Yes.
That the wave, and the wavefront will be parallel.
Yes.
Okay. Then let's go back to the problem. The problem says that we should observe the pattern using small objects, non-transparent objects.
Small non-transparent objects, exactly.
Then what is the definition of the small object in this problem?
Well, the definition of the small object, one of the slides, you can actually see the condition on the top. So, first of all,
So can you tell me qualitatively?
Yes, there are actually two reasons for that. The first and the major reason is we only use absolute values instead of the whole complex function. And this only works if the object is small, meaning that we have mainly not the interference of waves produced or refracted by the object with themselves, but interference of those objects with the reference beam, with the laser beam. Therefore, the object should only close on the small part or disturb on the small part of the laser beam. In this point, it is actually our method is actually comparable to holography. We use a reference beam and a small object.
Okay. And in your experiment, you use several kinds of shapes, like rectangular, light bulb.
Yeah, we use a lot of.
Okay. Then what if you use the polygons? What will be the shape and the intensity?
Well, can we have a reconstruction of the IYPT writing? Well, a sphere is also one polygon. I believe that this is also a polygon. It is not convex, but it is still a polygon consisting of straight lines.
I mean the main polygons, like triangle and circle, like this.
Well, again, we will be able to do exactly the same computations as in this case. Or should I describe how the patterns will look like?
May I go back to the previous slide? One more. Yes, in this case.
Yes.
You said the pattern like this.
Yes.
Will be appeared when you're using these kind of objects.
Yes.
And what if we use triangle and other polygons whose shape is different from the rectangulars?
Yes. Well, the problem about such patterns is, and this is a pattern taken in a distance of approximately 5 meters,
yes.
And the object itself, as you see, the whole image area is set to 5 millimeters.
Yes.
So the object itself is just a one part of a millimeter, meaning it is a small object. And if you put a triangle, the pattern would be not much different, because what we see here, the main structure, the rings, they are due to the interference. Similar to Fresnel interference, when we have an interference of a circular wave with a plane wave. Where you will see the difference, you can see small waves here, 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 and here. And this is actually where information about the sphere is contained. And for a triangle, you will see like patterns here, here, and here, which will again contain information about
only
the triangle.
Only three. When we use triangle, we can the pattern only this way.
And you will still, as I told you, you can see here, you will still see a very similar pattern, but small details where the information, well, those big patterns, rings, they contain information about the distance, and information about the form is contained in very small elements which you can cannot see from behind.
Okay. Then, when you locate the, in case of far field image,
yes.
If there's many objects who have the same size,
yes.
And when they are randomly distributed,
okay, I see.
What will be the pattern like?
Well, the pattern in the far field,
yes,
will actually be the same, because you see the scale in the far field is rather different as in the close field. You see, this is a pattern of approximately 1.6 meters some 1.6 meters. This means a small displacement of objects in millimeter range would not actually cause. Imagine we have several such patterns which are slightly displaced, but this displacement is very small in the far field, meaning that in the far field we will still observe the same pattern.
You mean that when the pattern is like this, if they are randomly arranged?
Yes.
The pattern like this will be shown again.
Well, if we also consider that the angle is randomly,
yes.
if we can also turn the square, you must imagine that then also those patterns will be turned, and then the result will be rather chaotic or rather equal distribution, because if we have a lot of waves in a lot of such patterns rotated chaotically, we will not have any clear interference patterns.
Then can you deduce any information about arrangement of objects when they are randomly or regularly arranged?
Well, we have not used a lot of objects. We did not put multiple objects in our beam to investigate, because actually you can see our IYPT tag as a lot of objects, as a lot of pixels, and you see we can clearly reconstruct each of them, so I think it's sufficient.
What if we use very, very small objects And when we try to find some information about very, very small objects using this status,
yes.
we cannot pick them one and one.
Yes.
We should locate them, all of it.
Of course, but you will, if the resolution is sufficient, well, in this case, the resolution is restricted to the resolution of the CCD chip. Okay, it is rather small in our case, so it is sufficient for such objects, and as long as the distance between objects you mentioned is bigger than our resolution, we will be able to recognize each single object, even
okay.
in three dimensions.
And my last question is, what information can you obtain?
Well, as for a non-transparent object, the only information which can be obtained is the shape of the object, meaning the cross-section of the object, or if we have multiple objects, we can also determine the distribution of this object in space. If we use semi-transparent objects,
yes.
then we can even obtain, we have done some reconstructions with semi-transparent objects, and then we can actually see, according the intensity will change accordingly to where the object is more or less transparent. So the pattern will again give us information about how transparent the object
okay.
is.
Okay, thank you very much. That was the last question. Thank you.
Okay,
or if the opponent should also stand up, you may be questioned.
So, good morning to everyone. First, I want to thank to the reporter and also to the opponent. I have the first one question for the reporter. Is the interference the only effect which is achieved here?
We have in this case wave optics. We can describe this as a combination of diffraction, because diffraction is actually an expression of the Huygens-Fresnel principle, and interference of those waves diffracted of the secondary surface waves. These are the effects here.
Okay, thank you. And what are the limitations of the object dimensions? So, for example, what is the smallest object that you can observe with this method?
Well, the smallest object, we have seen that for our text of approximately 0.3, well, you have actually seen the hair, it has 0.08 millimeters, and we could resolute this. This is still approximately 10 times the resolution of our CCD chip.
Okay,
so we cannot go much further because of the chip.
Thank you. And what is the error of that measurement?
Yes, the error of the measurement can be actually estimated. It is mainly due to reconstruction. It is mainly due to resolution you use during the reconstruction. If we vary the resolution, we see for big resolutions the shape remains the same, but for smaller resolutions we have an error of approximately several.
Thank you. I understand. So, how did you actually measure the intensity of your light, of the interference pattern?
Well,
you show us that the intensity is proportional to the square of electric field. Why is it? What is actually the sensor here?
Well,
what is the CCD?
A CCD is a so-called charge-coupled device.
It is
a basic element of a lot of cameras, and it's the property that the color value recorded is proportional to the intensity is actually achieved by the manufacturer. So we did not investigate this in detail because it is actually the aim of the manufacturer to ensure this proportionality.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, it is an approximation, but as you have seen, it is not relevant.
Okay, I understand. So you use this relation from the literature, from the data sheets of their CCD.
Well, I can explain this relation to you because the wave, the energy density of the wave is proportional to E squared. And it propagates.
Okay, thank you. And can you show me that equation, at first your equation with the this imaginary? So this is imaginary. Part of this do you use? Only real or the boat or only imaginary? What is it?
What we observe.
Yes.
What we observe is the absolute value, meaning the amplitude.
Okay, thank you.
So now the reviewer has 2 minutes to prepare the review, which will then take 3 minutes.
Lucas, and I will give you the short review of this problem. At first, I will tell something about the report. I can tell that the reporter has rather complete solution. His presentation was well structured. He showed us live here the experiment. He showed us the setup here. He also explained the basic optic terms and interference and the reason for the pattern formation. He also had a lot of mathematical modeling and pattern reconstruction in his presentation. He also talked about some fundamental things, for example, light nature, about pattern formation, about the accuracy of this method, and he also mentioned the practical applications of this method observed, of this observing method. But here are also some disadvantages. He was focused only on the interference here, not on the other possible effects. He also showed us, he also explained experiment limited. He only used coherent light, and he also used only one wavelength. His modeling and reconstruction was not explained enough clear, because there was little physics. It was a bit hard to understand in these 12 minutes, these integrals here. And there was also the lack of numerical values, lack of quantitative measurement. And in the presentation, there was not explained enough clear what information can be obtained from the pictures, but it was clarified in discussion. Now something for the opponent. He asked some fundamental questions. For example, he asked about Huygens' principle, he asked about the polychromatic white light, he asked about the distance between the objects and the CCD chips, he also asked about difference between objects and slits, he asked about the different shapes of objects, he also asked about computation and mathematical modeling. But he also has some disadvantages. He was only focused on the interference as a phenomenon. His inquiry about experiment was a bit limited. He didn't ask enough for the setup explanation for the intensity measurement method and experiment. And he could have asked more about the information, about what information can be obtained from this method. And now something about discussion. I can tell that the discussion was constructive and clarifying. The significant physical issues were discussed here, and also the experiment wasn't discussed enough here, and there wasn't mentioned the other effects wasn't mentioned. For example, the dispersion and some. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Okay, now the reporter has 2 minutes for concluding remarks.
Excuse me. Ladies and gentlemen, let me once again summarize in some detail what we have done. We have observed the pattern, and we have developed a complete mathematical description for this. Further on, we have applied appropriate approximations to be able to evaluate this model. I did not have time to explain the numerical algorithms in detail. The main part of our reconstruction algorithm is the fast Fourier transform, which is well known. Of course, also there are some tricks we have to apply in our simulation, which you can see on the right. But it works rather fast, and as you can see here, this is the image we have recorded at the beginning of the presentation as well as the reconstruction. Well, further on, I must say that the numerical information I was asked about is actually contained in all the pictures you have seen. Each of the pictures contains approximately 1 million of numerical values. And I think it is an evidence enough for extensive computations we have done. We have varied a lot of parameters. We have investigated the phenomenon in detail. We have shown how it can be applied to real objects. And therefore, I believe we have solved the problem. I would like to thank the opponent and the opponent team in general for the very interesting discussion. I was able to clarify some aspects in the discussion. I was able to go a bit more into qualitative aspects of our theory, which I have described in the presentation, quantitative as we needed for our reconstruction algorithm. I would like to thank the reviewer team for some further insights. And I would like also to thank all of you for coming here today for the final. Thank you for your attention.
Okay, so can I ask the reporter, opponent, and reviewer to make sure you are prepared for questions from the jury. 5 minutes we have to our disposal. First question will be put by Ginting from Indonesia.
Oh, well, congratulations for the German teams in Korea and also Croatia. I think you have a good presentation. You have shown us a good picture and experimental setup. But you also mentioned that pictures tell us a million measurements, but you showed there a hair. you put as a small object,
yes,
as the opossum says. But could you please tell us what is the size of the hair that you measure, and what is your measurement and with the error? Thank you.
The size of the hair we obtained from our measurement is 0.08 millimeter at the sharpest point. So we vary the distance until we get the sharpest image, and there we measure the distance. Of course, we can only say that it is the upper limit for the hair, so the hair could be a bit thinner. But I believe that within 10 to 20% the measurements are rather exact.
Okay, Fogo from Brazil.
And could you put your forms, please?
Yes. This one or the
okay.
next one?
Okay. Is it possible to get three-dimensional information about the object with these forms?
Three-dimensional information?
Yeah.
Well, mainly for non-transparent objects, we can only observe the cross-section, because if we have an object like this, so magnified, and we have a small object part behind here, we will not be able to see it because it lies in the shadow of the big part of the object. So we will only be able to see the biggest cross-section.
Okay. Yes, Lobachev from Russia.
Please tell me, what can you say about the shadow on the moon?
The shadow of what?
On the moon.
On the moon?
The shadow on the moon.
Well, the shadow on the moon, I'm not quite sure which shadow you refer to. If you mean moon phases, it is not actually a shadow, it is just only a part of the moon being illuminated by sun. And if you mean lunar eclipses, then it is the shadow of the Earth on the moon. I'm not sure I understand the question.
Shadow as it looks on the moon, I think is what it meant.
And you can see the shadow on the moon. You didn't even discuss about the geometrical approximation of shadows. So this is my question.
So I'm really not sure what shadow do you mean. Do you mean solar eclipses or lunar eclipses?
No,
or
I
what?
Think it's the shadow on the moon, when you are on the moon.
If I am on the moon?
Yes.
I can see the moon, yes.
You can see the shadow.
Oh, you mean the patterns on the moon we see?
Of course.
Well, this pattern are actually due to topology of the moon's surface. It is due to due to mountains on the surface which are illuminated differently, as the scale of those structures on the moon is some 100 kilometers, therefore we can observe it from here.
Sorry, I interfered in the wrong sense here. Yes, now, Francisco from Kenya.
My question goes to the presenter, Walter. Would you tell the relation between the wavelength and the pattern you observed?
Some experiments with a green laser like this one, so it's green, and the wavelength here is much smaller. This means that the diffraction pattern will occur for smaller lengths, so the patterns will be similar for smaller distances between the object and the screen. But there is no significant change, because our resolution in this case is not limited by the wavelength, but by the CCD chip we use.
Did you follow? No problem. Okay. Now, great for the reviewer. 9, 8, 8, 8, 9, 9, 8, 8, 9. Thank you very much for the journey.
Thank you for the reviewer. What are the other possible reasons or physical events or physical characteristics you would like to add?
So, for example, if you use the optically non-smooth object, then you may have some other effects, for example, dispersion or something like that. Not only these effects.
Okay, that was the question session of the jury. The reviewer, my right here. Nadolny, 9. Francisco, 9. Fogo, 8. Ginting, 8. Allinson, 9. Field, 9. Paganahammer, 8.
Good morning. My name is Sugyeong Kim from Korea Team, and it's a great honor to be here and show my presentation to the audience. And I'll start my presentation on number 6 with cleaning. First, the question. A wet bag is hard to drag when it is spread out and pulled across the floor. What does the resistive force depend on? And this is a simple diagram for the wet bag and what is in between the rack and the ground. First, let's start with a very basic concept. First, cohesion is attraction between the molecules of the same substance, and adhesion is attraction between the molecules of unlike substances. In general, solids are highly cohesive but only slightly adhesive, and liquids are highly adhesive but only slightly cohesive. First theory is lubrication. There are two kinds of friction. First, dry friction is friction between two bodies in absence of contamination, especially the liquid of the contact surfaces. And wet friction can be divided into two categories. First, the boundary lubrication. Although there is a water in between the object and the ground, since the water is not sufficient to make the full film, there are some breakdowns of the boundary film and increases the friction. And if the water is sufficient enough to make the full film, there is a full film lubrication occurs and decreases the friction. And my second theory is hydroplaning. Actually, hydroplaning is a term used for the car. When car is moving with high velocity in a rainy day, car is slightly lifted by the water film. And this is the equation to calculate the lift force of the hydroplaning. And what we can know from this equation is that with sufficient velocity and when lift force equals the hydrodynamic pressure force, the hydroplaning occurs. And this is the basic mechanism of the hydroplaning. Let's see when the object is static and the pressure over the yellow circle is the pressure of object plus atmospheric pressure. However, when object starts moving, the dynamic pressure here is included in the equation. And according to the Bernoulli's equation, as dynamic pressure increases, the static pressure decreases. So with the velocity, the object is lifted on the water film. This is my experiment diagram. There is a wet rag attached to the force sensor with a string, and force sensor is on the cart, and there is a motion sensor to check the motion of this whole system. And the main purpose of making this such a device is to keep the acceleration constant. Actually, the force recorded by the force sensor can be divided into two components. First, frictional force and acceleration force. However, in this case, since I made the MA term zero, we can say that recorded friction is directly equal to the frictional force. Okay? And this is my experimental setup. Here is a wet bag attached to the force sensor and with a string, and it is moving with this direction. And let's look at the simple moving claim for this opinion. When the power is turned on, it starts moving. And the power is turned off, it stops moving. And this is a general graph that we can get from the force sensor. As you can see in the upper graph of the acceleration, I only take the data when acceleration is in the range of plus minus 0.1 meter per square centimeter. And as you can see in the force graph in the below, it is reasonable to take the mean value of the force since the deviation is relatively small. First experiment deals with the water per unit area and frictional force. In this experiment, I increased the amount of water from 0 gram to 0.184 gram per square centimeter, and the total mass is kept constant. And let's look at the brief tendency of this graph. First, there's a sudden increase when the dry rack becomes wet rack, and there is an irregular change until it reaches 0.1 gram of water. And after the 0.1 gram of water, there is a rapid decrease, So from now on, let's discuss each tendency and figure out the reason for it. First, there is a sudden increase in frictional force when dry friction changes into wet friction. And this is a diagram for dry rack. Since the dry rack and ground are both solid, there is a weak adhesion exists. However, when the water becomes in between them, this weak adhesion changes into strong adhesion. So, we can say the liquid molecule's strong adhesion increases the frictional force and makes a sudden increase. And the second, gradual increase can be explained by the boundary lubrication, and rapid decrease can be explained by the full film lubrication. However, we contrast the three basic questions here. These are, first, why the tendency is irregular despite of increasing total water in the second range? And the second question is, why the tendency changes at 0.1 gram per square centimeter at this specific point? And is there any another factor except the lubrication? And this is the answer for the first question, why the irregularity appears despite of increasing total water? And then the answer is absorption of water. Although we increase the total amount of water so far, however, the total water can be divided into two parts, absorbent one and not absorbent one. However, in this case, the liquid film which creates lubrication is not absorbent water, not the amount of total water. So, until the rack contains the maximum amount of water, the increase in total water not always leads to the increase in not absorbent water. So, this causes the irregular change until the 0.1 gram per square centimeter. And I will answer for the second question, why is the 0.1 gram per square centimeter? And this is because the maximum absorption. Maximum absorption of the rack, we put the rack on the filtering paper, a bunch of filtering paper, and after a few minutes, we measure the increase in mass of the filtering paper, which is the water, mass of water not absorbed. And this is the graph we can get from this. As we can see in this graph, there is a sudden jump after 0.1 gram per square centimeter, which means this is the maximum absorption of water that a unit area of rack can contain. So, from this, we can explain that before the 0.1 gram, the boundary lubrication occurs, and after, the full film lubrication occurs. And is there any other factor? I think the hydroplaning effect certainly exists in this wet rack phenomenon. However, there is one qualification that has to be satisfied to make the hydroplaning effect. That is velocity high enough for the hydroplaning? And this is the equation to calculate the least velocity of the hydroplaning effect. And this is a general case for car. And this is the experimental case I used in this experiment for the rack. And since the decreasing ratio is almost constant with the equation, we can say that the velocity of rack used in this experimental value is sufficient speed for the hydroplaning effect. And second, we change the pressure effect. For a constant amount of water, we increase the pressure. And if the water is enough to make the full film lubrication, as the pressure increases, the kinetic frictional coefficient decreases because of the squeezing effect of the water. And we change the interfacial tension by putting the detergent on the water. And as the interfacial tension decreases, the adhesion force and cohesion force both decreases. So, we can say that interfacial tension decrease leads to lubrication effect to occur, and finally decreases the frictional force. And next, we change the if area. For the constant water, we change the area. As you can see in this graph, the increase in contact area leads to increase in frictional force. And the reason for this phenomenon is, the more molecules in contact, the larger the sum of intermolecular force. And this is the basic difference that is from the dry rack and the wet rack. And we change the surface texture for the rougher rack with a lower absorbing ability. This graph shows us that we can see the decrease in frictional force when the dry rack becomes wet rack, which is quite different from the graph we just saw. So This graph tells us that since the absorbing ability of this wave is too small, that it already passed the maximum absorption. And for the next tendency of this graph, tells us that there is no certain phenomenon of lubrication or hydrogen planning effect. And we think that is due to the roughness of the surface texture. Okay, then look at the surface texture. If the surface texture becomes rougher and rougher, that there exists a path for trapped water to escape, delaying the buildup of water film. So, the roughness finally obstacles the hydroplaning or lubrication effect. And we finally chase the type of the floor effect, and we can see here the paper has a very high frictional force, which means the paper absorbs water. And also, when I pull the rag on the sandpaper, it does not move because it was too rough to be pulled. So, we can conclude the roughness and absorption ability of the floor influence the friction. And this is my conclusion. First, the basic theory in my presentation is that resistive force of the red rag depends on the lubrication and hydroplaning effect. And the lubrication and hydroplaning effect, the magnitude of these factors are depends on the following variable. First, the water. If the water is 0 grams, the dry friction occurs, and if the water is less than 0.1 gram per square centimeter, the irregularity occurs, and this is because of the boundary friction. And if the water is more than 0.1 gram per square centimeter, there is a rapid decrease in the graph, and we can explain this by the full film lubrication. And here, the 0.1 gram is the maximum amount of water a unit area, a square centimeter of a rag, can contain. And last, as these are some variables I took in experiment. First, if the pressure increases, the frictional force, the frictional coefficient decreases. And if surface tension decreases, the frictional force decreases. And as area decreases, the friction decreases. And for the surface texture, as the roughness increases, the hydroplaning and lubrication effect is hard to occur. And when we change the type of floor, the absorbing ability or the roughness can change the friction. Thank you for your attention, and this is the end of my presentation.
Thank you. Now the public has 2 minutes for questions to the reporter.
Hello everyone. I'm Yusuf from the Croatian team. Thank you for this very nice presentation. I have some questions. Why is the rag wet?
Because rags consists of very small fibers and it is a mass of the fiber. And between the fiber and fiber, there is a very small hole. And because of the capillary effect, this is the major factor for the
adhesion. Can you tell me on microscopic level, what is adhesion?
Adhesion. Adhesion is a force attraction between the molecules of different substances, such as a rag and a substance.
Yes, so why it happens on the microscopic level?
Because of intermolecular force.
Oh, what kind of intermolecular force?
You know, there is a force between molecules and molecules. That is why every material exists. So I think this is a basic equation, basic mechanism.
Okay, we'll get back to it. What is the velocity dependence? When we increase the velocity or decrease the velocity, how does the force change?
And I will show in the equation of the hydroplaning effect, as the velocity increases, the hydroplaning effect more occurs, and I think the frictional force decreases. However, in this experimental setup, the change in velocity that we can afford is very small. So I think, and actually I had an experiment, and we can see no big change in the difference of frictional force. But however, if the experimental device allows us to make very big difference in velocity, there should be a big difference in a surface.
What about the change in temperature?
I kept the temperature of the water constant. I think if the temperature increases, the surface tension decreases, so it leads to the frictional force decrease.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. You will now...
Catherine, I wanted to give the review of the problem or the report we have just heard. So what has been the positive aspects of the report? First of all, it was a rather comprehensive presentation with a lot of graphics, a lot of graphs where the measured data were shown, and the video, which also illustrated what the reporter has done. Also, we saw extensive measurements, which was mainly based, or the report was mainly based on experimental, with a lot of variation, for example, the surface and the water amount of the stretch. Also, there were also other parameters like surface conductivity. But influence of further parameters, for example, the viscosity has been not really investigated. They just put, for example, detergent in it, but they didn't investigate what influence does it actually have to the resisting force of the drag. And they didn't take other drag types into consideration, which is actually a main point in the problem. Also, there is no quantitative theory for the resisting force, and there were no alignment between the theory and the experimental side of our report. Also, the critical water amount was not estimated clearly enough. So we can just say that it was a qualitative investigation of the problem, not a quantitative. Now I just want to come to the opponent. The opponents highlighted the positive aspects, for example, the various experiments which were really impressive in this case. But he also noticed a lack of theoretical description of the phenomenon. But he failed to elaborate on some other parameters in his presentation. He just put it into this discussion. He could have used more time for this in your presentation. And sometimes the opposition was not detailed enough, I just stated before. So let's just come to the discussion. What we have seen was an interesting discussion. This discussion was mainly on experiments, which was clear in case that the report was also based on experiments mainly. And the opponent attempts to clarify some importance, for example, of the viscosity in this case. But also there were some disadvantages or some negative aspects, like, for example, the insufficient clarification of physical background. For example, I just want here to mention that they didn't attempt to clarify the reason for the attention force varies in physical meaning. And they also didn't try to clarify the force acting during the aquaplaning, which the reporter presented to us just at the beginning of her report. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you. So we can have the reporter back on the stage with 2 minutes concluding remarks.
Okay, I first thank your opponent team and its reviewer team and my audience. And I'm going to make some concluding remarks on number 6, web cleaning. And yeah. These are some of the discussed points and final remarks. First, how does the rag absorb water? And I answer this question by saying that the main reason for absorption is capillary effect. And secondly, the range or effective velocity. I said that velocity is also an important factor in determining the resisting force. However, the experimental device did not allow me, very unfortunately. And this, the basic reason for adhesion and cohesion. The basic reason for this is the intermolecular force, which is mostly caused by the electrons and some mechanism. And also, the roughness of rag type. Both opponent and reviewer team said that I didn't change the rag type or the roughness, but I want to say that I actually changed the roughness and absorption ability of the rag and did an experiment and showed you results. And also, the effect of area. As the area increases, some of the intermolecular force increases and finally increases the resistive force. And also, the conception of surface tension and viscous force, and we also discussed about this. And I again thank you for the reviewer team and opponent team, and thank you for all. Thank you.
So, we have come to the point on the program where the jury can ask questions. We have 5 minutes for this. Fogo from Brazil.
Okay, could you give me 4 parameters to the maximum adhesion? Four parameters for maximum adhesion.
The maximum adhesion of the water? Yeah, if I increase, as I show in the graph, as I increase the amount of water per unit area, we can see the peak point there, and I think that's the maximum of adhesion, and that is the most proper thickness of the water making up maximization force.
Did you vary these parameters or I'd like area and kind of leak? Did you vary these parameters?
I'm sorry.
Okay.
Vary the parameters? Yes, I vary the parameters as you see I decide my presentation.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Ginting from Indonesia.
Yes, I have a question to the reporter and also to the opponent. The opponent asked you about, did you measure the distance between the rack and the floor? And you said, theoretically, you calculated, and how did you do that? And for the opponent, you really asked a question about the adhesion force, is it vertically or horizontally? Can you explain why did you ask that? Thank you.
Because the force, the resistant force, should be in the direction opposite of the velocity of the pulling, and the adhesion force should be pointed downwards. So I ask her how does the adhesion suddenly becomes opposite of the pulling direction, and that's why I think it's important.
What do you think? Wow.
I don't think that the adhesion here plays that role in the pulling. I think that adhesion is the main factor in the resistive force.
For the boundary, of the replication, I said that there is a theoretical value of the thickness which makes the boundary of the replication, and the thickness I think is like the 10 times of the water molecule, this water molecule size, which means the water molecule has a property of the short length interaction, which means it moves together for the water molecule. So in the case of boundary of the replication with that thickness, the adhesion force between the rag and the water molecule and the water molecule and the surface of the ground occurs more. However, if it changes into full replication, rather than the adhesion force between the top and the bottom, the cohesion force in the water molecule affects more to the frictional force. Thank mm-hmm. you.
Short question. Lobushev. My name is Lobushev. This is a question for all the three teams, from the reviewer to the reporter. If we shall take plastic sheet, a sheet of plastic film, if the effect will be in general the same or not? So the first review.
First of all, I want to say that in this case we didn't have any menisc between the plastic surface and our table, but if we are really increasing the humidity, so if we have just a water film on which our plastic is put, there will be an effect which we can compare to our rack if there's a lot of water between the plastic and the table surface.
Opponent?
I think that what you mean when you have a plastic, not a fiber. Yes. I think that the achieved effect will be similar. We will have a greater force between the plastic and the plate when we put water, but it's not the same. It's not completely the same, but we will have the same effect. Similar effect.
And the major difference between the plastic and water the rag is that it cannot absorb. So as you put water, the lubrication effect occurs more faster. However, I think for the plastic, there suddenly exists the sudden increase when it changes from dry friction to wet friction.
Okay, time for one short question more. Not only.
I'd like to ask you to show us the formula for the force in which the weight of the difference in weight between wet and dry rack are taken into account.
I think, as I said, the squeeze effect as it increases the mass. And however,
the formula, please.
No, I guess.
Are you able? Can you show the formula?
The lift force equation?
Yes, the force.
Yes.
Well, the weight of the rack is taken into account. I mean the difference between wet and dry rack.
In this case? I think the width is also an important factor. The area...
Can you show the formula where you show the difference between a wet rag and a dry rag?
No, I have no formula for that.
Thank
but I have a polytestive
explanation. Okay, thank you
thank
very
you.
Much. So, the time is up, so I ask the jury to write down their grades. And I will come by. So, we will show the grades now, and I will start from the right again, not only. I will not repeat the names. Please show the grade for the reporter. 8, 9, 8, 9, 7, 7, 9, 9, 7, 8. And now, please, the grade for the opponent. 8, 8, 9, 8, 7, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8. Are you following? Yes. And finally, the grade for the reviewer. Please show the grade. 9, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 9, 8, 9, 9. Thank you very much.
Okay, Amrit. So, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It is my great honor to present our solution to problem number 8, electrostatics, in this last stage of the last physics fight of this IYPT. So, first, to remind you of the problem, it says propose and make a device for measuring the charge density on a ruler wrapped with a cloth. So, first, I would like to give an introduction, which will be, in fact, the basics of our solution. So, first, I will talk about the cloth, the plastic ruler, and the charging process a little. Then about the principle of our charge measurement, about the construction of our device, the calibration of this device, and finally about the measurement on the real sample and the charge calculation from the obtained measurements. First of all, ruler charging. So, in order to have anything to measure, we have to take a ruler and charge it to the cloth as the problem states. Now, this charging is quite a complicated process of transfer of electrons between the ruler and the cloth material, and I won't go into explaining it deeper because it is extremely not very nice. Generally, we can only say that this effect depends on the molecular structure of the ruler and of the cloth. However, a very important point is that our plastic ruler is, in fact, non-conductive. So, if you put the charges on a ruler in a certain fashion, these charges will stay where you put them, however large they are. This is only a property of non-conducting dielectric materials, as the plastics we used. High charge density will occur only at the rubbed portion. So what we did is we rubbed the ruler locally and then could obtain maps of this charge. Our ruler was made of polymethyl methacrylate. It is a plastic plexiglass, and we always cleaned it thoroughly with alcohol in order to remove all possible stains, conducting grease, etc., which might influence the flow of charge on the ruler surface and from the ruler. Our cloth was a woven cotton, as you see, and as I have already said, we used localized rubbing, so we rubbed the ruler only in two or three points,
And then we hope to observe charge peaks at those points exactly. Now the measurement principles. There are many charge detection principles. Some of them are mentioned here, so you can use certain colloid powders to see where they accumulate and take that as a measure of charge. You can use the vibrating capacitor method, which is quite popular. You can use a cantilever, which is in fact the method of functioning of the atomic force microscope. And you can use the electrostatic mill, which is in fact a measurement of the electric field. And exactly this method we have chosen for our charge measurements. Now, the principle of operation of this electrostatic mill is as follows. You have, for example, you have one period, and this period you divide into parts. In the first part, this field detector is subjected to an electric field coming from the charge, and you have some sort of signal which is proportional, more or less, to the charge or to the field. However, in the second half period, you cover this detector up with a grounded plate. And because on this grounded plate, charges are induced, so as to make this plate stay on zero potential, there is no electric field above this plate. And your detector measures no signal. And so if you do this periodically, you will get an alternating signal from your detector. And to obtain this, you construct the chopper, which was a grounded plate, rotating, and it has those three holes, so you periodically cover and uncover this field detector. This kind of measurement induces lots of nice possibilities, like if you have a frequency or phase reference for the signal, you can lock the signal in phase and remove all possible noises. You can also determine the sign of the charge, which is a different matter, also connected with phase, I will explain it. And it enables you to measure your signal very accurately because you have no noise. Now, the field detector is the second very important part of our setup. And this field detector was, in fact, consisting of a thin metal plate connected to a FET transistor. A FET transistor is a field effect transistor. How it exactly works is quite complicated. I have made a simplified explanation. So, in fact, the field you subject the detector to displaces the charge on this detector and displaces the charge in this transistor as well. And the current through the transistor, which is measured, depends on the potential difference between two points. I will show you this in picture here. So this is our field detector. This plate, it's a metal plate, and if you subject it to a field, for example, such a field, then the electrons will gather here and leave a surplus of positive charges or holes because this is a p-doped material. In fact, this zone here would get larger, the larger your potential difference is. And this is why the current through the transistor will diminish or grow if you reverse the field direction. Now, the whole device, of course, couldn't have been consisting only of that. We had probe and chopper to measure the field. And as I have drawn, the probe was in a large grounded plate to get more accurate measurements. I will explain that. Also, we had a photodiode, which you have perhaps seen on the picture. It served as a frequency and phase reference. And these two signals, reference and real signal, were conducted to signal processing electronics, which were some amplifiers and a locking loop. And also we had an XY translator for scanning the ruler, so we moved the probe across the ruler. This is a schematic block diagram, so the signal channel, the reference channel, combined in a lock-in in order to remove the noise, and the signal was recorded with a PC, which in turn controlled the translator to move the detector above the sample. This is a picture of the whole device realized. Now, first of all, the probe. So this is schematic of the probe. As I have already drawn, this is the chopper which rotates, a photodiode, the sensing plate and some wires, and we use a motor from a cell phone causing vibration, so it is quite a good use for it. This is a picture of the probe. So here, once again, the detector, the photodiode, and the chopper.
Now signal processing, it was mainly this FET transistor in the FET amplifier to measure the charge or the electric field. And for the reference, we had an amplifier and filter to remove the DC offsets from the photodiode. The XY translator was built out of junk, out of old printers, so we made it all by ourselves. And here you see how it was able to move the probe across the sample. The resolution achieved was quite fine, as you shall see. So now calibration. Calibration is very important because it enabled us to measure the charge very accurately and exactly. And what we did, in fact, is that we had a metal plate which we subjected to a known voltage. Then we put our probe above it and measured, well, the signal, the feedback signal. What we did is that we approximated these two plates like a capacitor plate and said that the field was just proportional to the voltage. This is the realization. This is quite a good approximation at the center because the boundaries are far away. And using this technique, we could obtain a calibration graph. Here is shown the signal we get from the detector and the plate voltage. So we see we can measure negative as well as positive charge or voltage. And the electric field, we measure only the perpendicular component, was calculated with this connected to our measurement. So now the last point was the field sample, real sample measurements. What we did first were field maps. So we just scanned our ruler and obtained some sort of map of electric field at a distance from the ruler of, as you see, 5 millimeters. The step size was 1 millimeter. That was approximately the size of the probe of the detector as well. And because this step size is much smaller than, not much, but quite smaller than the distance, we couldn't just take the charge underneath the probe to be proportional to the measured signal, but had to use some sort of deconvolution. We made two measurements, the same ruler, but different rubbings. The first map has about 6,000 points all in all, and the second map has about 5,000 points. This is our ruler. So now you will see a movie of the device in action. So this is, as you see, the XY translator, and it scans the ruler in such a fashion that you can achieve an accurate field map. And these are the results. So for two different rubbings, same ruler, we rub this ruler in two different points, and as predicted, in those points we get charge peaks or field peaks for the moment. It is very strange that for the first scan we managed to obtain positive as well as negative charges. This has probably something to do with the charge transfer process, and we couldn't really quite satisfactorily explain this. Now, to calculate the charge, we had to make clear that the field at one center position is induced by the fields of all the charges on the ruler. And the field due to one charge is given by this equation, which is just simply Coulomb's law, and the net field is the sum of all the influences. That means that at one center point, the net field is given by this sum. The factor of 2 instead of 4 is because the grounded plate induces charges, so we effectively had 2 rulers. And now if you scan the whole ruler, you get a system of equations for each point, from which you can calculate all the charge densities. We did it numerically by Bose method. It was quite a large number of points, so we couldn't do it by hand. And these are the final results. So you see, these are real charge maps. The calibration yielded exact numbers for charge. The charge is in microcoulombs per meter squared. And as you see, the structure remains approximately the same, but the edges are sharper, which is of course due to this charge calculation, because it is quite an exact method. So to conclude, we have constructed the charge scanning device based on an electrostatic mill, and the charge on the ruler could be measured fast and quite reliable because our spatial resolution was about 1 millimeter or even better perhaps. The sensitivity we achieved was 10 nanocoulombs per meter squared, but it could be even more enhanced, and the complete scan time for 5,000 points was about 3 minutes, and the charge drift in this time was less than 5%, which we measured, so we can say that our device is quite an accurate method of measuring this charge density. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Interesting presentation. My name is Rina Hunter from the German team, and I have several questions. So, can you explain in short why the electrodes stay on the ruler?
Why they stay on the ruler?
Yes,
the ruler.
Short. Call it
well, it is a matter of structure because the ruler material is plastic, and it is some sort of polymer molecule, and these electrons get in fact caught by some sort of instabilities of this molecule, so to say. So it is a matter of structure. It doesn't have a trivial explanation why they will stay on it.
Okay, how long do you need for one measurement over the whole ruler?
As I said, the measurement time was about 3 minutes for 5,000 points, so not more than 5 minutes. And during this time, yes.
Do you have any verification for your resolution you showed us?
Which resolution?
Of your device.
Well, the resolution was 1 millimeter that was given by the device.
Do you have a verification for that?
Well, we measured it. I mean...
So, you did your calibration that you used for that metal plate. Is the charge density on this plate at all points the same?
Of course not, because this plate is finite and you have finite edge effects, etc. But we can say that in the middle where our detector was situated, it is quite a good approximation to use a finite, infinite plate.
Is the field between your probe and the ruler homogeneous? What do you think?
Well, it might not be completely homogeneous, and this is a fact we have accounted for by calculating the field. You have seen this equation. So this is in fact stating that the field is not homogeneous, but due to all the...
So, yes, why are the measurements not affected by the horizontal component of the field?
Why?
You should, yes.
Last question.
It
last
is because, this... So here you see that we have this ground plate coming quite close to the detector. So if you would have some sort of horizontal component, this boundary would kill it off because the charge has to be at zero potential always.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Can you borrow another microphone, please?
Okay, once again, thank you for your quite interesting presentation. And yes, the slide, please. So, what we saw was a clear structured presentation, so the slides were very structured. We saw a video from the measurements, so that we could imagine how it works. The qualitative explanation of the basics and of the effect was very good explained, and a very interesting engineering approach. But it was very hard to follow to the electronic detail. So he showed the slide only for a few seconds, and I didn't get what it means, maybe later in the discussion. To the experiment, what we saw was a quite good high-level device, which allows to measure with a high density, with a high resolution and has a good sensitivity. So there was some self-made parts. He used also the well-known mode that is known, and the calibration was done. But he had not ensured a reproducible charging, so he charged the ruler by using his hand, and the sensor was very small. So, do we have then a homogeneous field? I don't think so. Yes, some parameters were not varied. For example, to use different rulers, the thickness of the ruler, and so on. And we had no comparison, and this is a very important point, with a professional device. And some measurements were not presented here, for example, how the charge changed with the time. So you need 3 minutes for one measurement. So let's come to the theory. He showed us a good numerical approximation, and also he used a computer program for solving the equation. So he had one equation for each point. So the algebra was solved by the computer. Yes, but there was no considered the influence of the device itself on the field. So could the charge be influenced by that? And the ruler thickness was not considered, so we have a distance of 5 millimeters, and the ruler, I think, it's in this range. So do we have to consider then the charge over the whole volume? So we can't consider only on the surface. So, thank you. I'm looking forward to the discussion.
Yes, so if I could give some comments on this first. So please, the slide, please. Yes, so a reproducible charging is quite an important issue because we might have taken, for example, some sort of high voltage pin and connected it to the ruler to ensure reproducible charging. But the problem itself states that we have to measure the charge on the ruler roughly with a clock. So I think that we just didn't go into it because it's quite complicated and we didn't think...
You had a very good device, so why you don't build a device, for example, a component for the rubbing?
I think that's an interesting idea, but I think that rubbing can't be the same every time. So it could perhaps be, but I think that the difference between rubbing with your hand and with some sort of robotic arm, I don't know, it would be much work, but not really.
So can you explain us here? You see, I thought that the charges are not staying on the ruler. So you draw the line, the field line, from the negative to the positive. Are the field lines here right?
Perhaps not. It depends on the convention, of course. This is just schematic. So
it is known that the charges stay on the ruler.
The charges do stay on the ruler.
In an isolator. So are the field lines here right as you draw them?
It depends on the sign of the charge. Because the field lines... this is just a sketch. So the field lines, of course, aren't... The field is not homogeneous. But if the arrows point upwards or downwards...
But I'm asking for the direction.
Yes, that depends on the charge and on the convention. Okay. So if you take the field points from negative to positive,
yes,
then they are correct. But if you assume that the
yes. Okay. Can you explain me here, maybe with a laser, how the field line looks like from ruler to your device or to your probe?
They
look like, you know, how big is your probe there, your sensor?
As I said, this is just schematic. So
yeah,
our sensor
how
is very
is
small compared to
how small
the ruler, about 1 millimeter in diameter.
Okay, so can you show us how the field line would be in this case for a probe which is only 1 millimeter in diameter? So
I think that is not quite important because I think that the smaller the probe, the more homogeneous the field is in the region of the probe.
No,
the field line would be something like this.
You use an equation for a capacitor, where the field lines are, yes.
No, that was used only in the calibration process, because the capacitor is this.
Okay, but how would the line look here?
Well, just like this, approximately.
Do you think that in this region we have homogeneous, so this line?
It's not homogeneous, as I said.
How do you look like?
So it probably would look something like this, but I suppose that, for example, it would be not quite straight,
okay,
on the borderlines, etc.
Let's come to a basic question. So what do you think? How are the charges produced on the surface of the ruler?
Yes.
What's the main effect?
As I said, the discharge transfer mechanism is very complicated.
Qualitatively, maybe you can explain it.
Well, the point is, as far as I know, that what matters is the structure, the molecular structure of the fibers of the cloth and of the ruler itself. So they are all organic molecules. And in organic molecules,
we
have some sort of...
What happens to wild contact of two materials?
Yes. Now, if you just put them in contact, these there are some sort of delocalized electrodes, say, in those materials, and they can freely jump from one to the other.
So which effect has the rubbing on that?
Rubbing has just the effect that you bring the cloth very close to the material.
So in fact, rubbing, I don't think rubbing is quite necessary because obviously you don't just rip the charges off the material.
Is it only for the distance between your gloves and the ruler? Do you think that's right? Or is it due that some parts of the ruler are not yet has not the same density of electrodes like ours?
Yes, of course. That's why we have rubbed the ruler just at some parts, and then we observed those peaks, charge peaks,
okay.
Which say that the
see.
Ruler was rubbed.
Could you explain me how such a mill works? So you use in your apparatus such an electrostatic mill?
Yes.
Could you explain me how
it works? Now, this is just the principle how it works.
Yes.
So you have one period.
You build up something like a propeller and
exactly.
Sometimes
now, this schematic is when you have no ground plate, so this is open to the field. Now, if you close this, yes, then this plate blocks the field and you get no signal. So what you get is signal, no signal. So if you do this, you have an alternating signal from the probe. And our chopper was only ensuring that this plate. What it did is that it periodically covered and uncovered this section.
And further question to the ruler. So if you use such a ruler, I think the thickness is in the range of 5 millimeters.
Even less.
But in the range. Wouldn't you say that it has an influence because we have used from Gaussian law, I think, that we have here density over the whole volume and not only on the surface?
Yes, it is a very important point to state, which I have probably missed during the presentation, that we have rubbed only one side of the ruler, not both. So the charges stick only to the upper side and they do not penetrate the ruler.
So which side do you use then for the measurements? Only the side
the
you rub?
The side, yes. So we didn't rub this side, or if
and
we had, we would have some charges
and you
here
think,
as well.
You think still the volume has no influence on that?
The ruler is negative. The ruler is neutral in itself. So what we did, we added charges only to the surface. And they are a planar distribution, so the volume should have no influence.
Can you explain me for a second time, I didn't get that, why you don't need the horizontal component of the field?
Why don't measure it?
Yeah, no, why you don't need it?
I don't need it because I don't measure it. I can't measure it because, say you have such a field vector and you divide it into this and this component. This plate, this ground plate, is very close to our center.
Yeah. I see. Okay.
Yes. And now, this component is completely, sort of damped off by the field, by the charges produced on this plate. So what you have left is only this upward component.
I see.
Of course, this is only an approximation because
so let's
it's not complete.
Let's talk for a second time for the mill. So what happens in the ruler if, here it's open and we have a field?
The ruler remains unchanged.
So what happens in your probe here?
What happens in the probe is that when you have an open, when you don't have this plate, then charges, this detector is made of metal and it has three electrons inside. Now, depending on the direction of the field, so on the sign of this, those electrons will move. They will either accumulate here or escape from here and leave only the plug in the field left.
This is the effect of polarization, isn't it?
Or something like that.
Okay, but there are two kinds. So, which polarization is here? So,
it is not exactly polarization, it is just charge movement because here you have, as I said, the metal itself is neutral and you have mobile electrons. When you subject them to a field, they will move until they form a potential difference that neutralizes this field force.
Can you show us your graph? So I saw some points where some negative and positive area.
As I mentioned in the presentation, it is very, very strange.
Can you explain it?
Especially on this here scan, we obtained both positive and negative charge. I can't say that I really know why this is so. So this is experimentally obtained. It has probably something to do with the charge transfer process, but as I said, this is quite complicated, so I really don't know why this is as it is.
But what do you think? What could be the
effect? It might be some sort of
influence, like you put a lot of negative charges here and then they maybe repel some negative charges, leaving only positive ones or something like that. But those are all speculations, so I can't give you an exact explanation of why this is so.
So did you try to rub with different materials and
No.
Did you?
No. We would use only one cloth and one.
Do you think that areas are characteristic only for such a plastic ruler or?
No, it depends on both substances you use. So the plastic ruler and the cloth are just one pair. You could use, I don't know, some sort of silk or something like that. And I suppose that the design would be different.
Okay. Can we go to the theory? So you use here two approximations. The first one is that you calculate your system by using the sums and not integrals as usually, and the second is by solving the matrices or what you have. So what do you think, how or did you approximate this, how high is the error of such a calculation?
The error is very small in the middle of the ruler, but at the edges it could be a little bit larger because of some sort of edge effect or not complete scanning or something like that. So I think this is quite an accurate method because it enables us to get a very high resolution.
Yeah. While measuring your ruler, the charge on the ruler is changed.
Yes. Now that is one point we had investigated as well, and I just didn't have time to show it in the presentation. So one very important point is if the ruler is dirty or clean. So if it has some sort of grease or dirt.
Why should it be? What's the effect?
Yes. Now dirt is usually conducting. Why is it so? It's very complicated because you have some sort of mobile charges, blah blah. But generally, what we have discovered is that the dirt is conducting, and so this is a dirty ruler. A signal in time, the signal is proportional to the charge, and this is a clean ruler cleaned with alcohol, so there was no grease on it whatsoever. And as you see, the drop of charge in our typical scanning time of 300 seconds or 5 minutes. Is very small, so it's about 10%.
Would you say this is something like an exponential function?
Perhaps. We try to fit.
For example.
Yeah, we try to fit an exponential function, and it is not quite so. So it has
what
some deviation.
So some linear parts or?
I don't know. It is probably a very complicated function. It is not exponential.
How would you describe this qualitatively? Do you have an idea?
Well, I suppose this charge leakage is due to two effects. First of all, discharging into the air because you have some moist air, and then the charges can escape the ruler. But this is secondary to the effect of charge transport on the ruler itself. Because if you have a thin layer of grease, for example, on your ruler, then the charge can escape through this grease to the supports and to the ground.
Okay.
Then you have a very high leakage.
I'm afraid the time is out. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Stay on the stage, now the reviewer will come up and ask questions. I suppose you have to transport the microphone.
Hello, my name is Song Xiangmu, the member of Korean team. And first, I really appreciate for very nice discussion number 8, electrostatics. We have some questions. First, for the reporter, do you think there's a difference between ordinary charge sensor and your device? Just ordinary charge sensor and your device.
It's supposed to be an ordinary charge sensor.
Just professional charge sensor, yeah.
So professional charge sensors are mainly designed according to the few methods I have mentioned. I haven't seen such an application in practice. So the principle might be different, but I think the accuracy is quite well compared to some of those sensors.
In your experiment, did the ruler electrify the minus or plus?
As I have shown in those charge graphs, we got both. So we can't explain exactly why this is so, but the fact is that we got both. So here mostly minus, and here both.
In your experiment, did you consider the humidity and temperature of air when you rubbed with cloth?
Yes, That's exactly one of the factors I mentioned to which the charge leakage is due. But we have discovered that the cleaning the ruler is much more important than really considering the humidity. However, it was always conducted in a very dry room, so it was qualitatively took care of.
And in your experiment, did you fix the distance between mill and electrified ruler? Fix the distance?
The distance was always 5 millimeters, I wrote that.
So you mean in this experiment, the distance between two things is not important factor to measure charge density?
It is important because it enters the calculation, because the further you are, the smaller the field will be. But it is not principally important.
For our opponent, you said when you have discussion, there is a movement of charge when rubbing.
I didn't get it.
There is a movement of charge when I rub with the clothes.
Yes.
So can you explain the mechanism?
Yes. I think if we have a contact between two bodies, there we have different densities of the number of charges, okay?
Yeah.
So due to this, we have something like a current from or a stream from one material to another. And then if we have a conductive material, we bring it away.
I think you understand. And how did you regulate the intensity of rubbing?
We didn't really regulate it. We rubbed it pretty hard. I don't know really how hard it was. So it wasn't a control parameter.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.